Welcome back. It is still Rush Hour. My name is Lynn Comish. I told you, join our conversations on social media, on Twitter and on Facebook at Urban Television, at Urban TV Uganda. Also download the new Vision Experience app, and we also there under the TV section. Now we talk business, and joining us is Simon Okitera and of course Vincent Kagame, a business analyst. We're going to look at why most startups collapse before they even start. I mean, you start and then before we know it, you're gone. A very good morning to you, gentlemen, and welcome to the show.
Thank you, Lynn. And you know, that statement you just made there of businesses collapsing before they even start is quite interesting, because I tell you what, if most people don't get the basics right at the start, then they're bound to collapse. I mean, the businesses before they even start. And you know, in such times when everyone talks about fuel as being one of the drivers of the cost of doing business generally, I think what most people are forgetting are the basics of what must be done before we start these businesses. For instance, we talk about not being ready. We know that after COVID happened, almost everyone just went out, and you know, if you lost a job, then the opportunity is start up something that can help you make some money. But let me not make so much statements into this, because I have an expert here who should be telling us just why there are so many businesses collapsing before they even see 3-6 months from the time they start. Vincent, once again, welcome to the Business Clinic this morning. Let's start from there. Why do we see so many businesses starting and failing in less than 3 months?
Basically, we are looking at maybe the market environment in which these businesses are operating in. So the main thing here, we are looking at maybe the quality in terms of the product and the service. Now, if you are to look at the performance, what drives the existence of this business? Now, the main thing here is demand. Is the product you are offering or service, is it on demand? Now, if there is less demand, the performance is a bit low in terms of the products you bring out or the service you are offering. So the driving force here is demand. Now, if there is less demand for your product or service, which gives you a wake-up call, what should you do in order for you to, let's say, increase your demand?
So as a business person, how are you able to tell that the products I'm offering in the market does not have demand?
Yeah, because maybe this demand is driven by, let's say, the quality in terms of the product or the service. So depending on the quality of the service or the product you are offering, it is that will drive the demand, on depending on how people are looking for your product. Yes,
but look, Vincent, right now someone would imagine that almost everyone is trying to find something to use in their households. We see food prices going high, commodity prices generally going high. Why would someone then fail if you're running a business? Why would you fail in these times when there is obvious demand from everyone?
Yeah, that's what will differentiate you from others in terms of the quality of the service or the product you are offering.
Yes.
Now let's say if in terms of the pricing, if you are all, let's say, offering the same product, how are you going to ensure that you differentiate yourself from others? Yeah, so that will bring about convenience. How are you going to ensure that your product or service is easily accessible? Then you look at the value you are creating in the marketplace, because it is this service or product that yield vary in the marketplace that will fetch a higher return.
Okay.
So if you are able to create a vary, and this vary will be created by the quality of the product, that we will be able to maybe charge a higher higher price that will give you a higher return.
All right, so first point there is, for anyone that is starting a business, it's important to ensure that what you're supplying on the market, one, has demand. But for you to stand out different from other business people or business persons, ensure that your product is of quality. What unique feature does your business have over other businesses? Let's talk about lack of compelling economic outlook. Because like I said at the start, when COVID happened, almost everyone thought, okay, fine, I lost my job, I can start a business and thrive. Is that the kind of conversation you must be having?
Because that is an ongoing conversation. Mm. Because now it is, that one is driven by the knowledge, the marketing knowledge, in terms of what is currently trending, what is happening. And that will be guided by the demand. You look at, you are supposed to bring out a product or service that is being maybe talked about, or that is on high demand, which takes us back. So the knowledge, the market knowledge, or the current happenings should be able to drive or should be guiding you on the product or service that you bring out that is currently on demand.
Okay.
Yeah, because now, if you are to look at, because now things are changing fast, depending on the economic environment. Mm. So you need that market knowledge to guide you in what is currently happening, because that will prevent you from providing what is already on the market.
Okay.
So if you have the knowledge, if you have, you are well conversant with the current products that are on demand, then it will guide you in for you to bring out a product that is of quality and that is of high value.
Right, good stuff. So we're talking quality and we're talking research, understanding what the market wants, understanding the market dynamics and how faster they are changing. How can you entangle in and ensure that you play along to the safe? So some business people then will tell you, I could have made it in my first 6 months, but I didn't have funding or financing. The cost of financing or the cost of finance in this country is too high. We saw the other day the central bank talk about 8.5 CBR. That is an indication that, well, the commercial banks will again look into how can we regulate more money going out. And then the people will say, I cannot start. Of course, there are those who have saved. But is this one of the biggest excuses that a business that is failing should be holding on to?
Yeah. I think that has been overemphasized. But for us, we are focusing on maybe individual businesses, let's say small, medium, and large, depending on the level at which you are at.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of funding, what drives your funding? Because you may want to bring out something that is not on demand. However much you have or you invest in that business, it will not yield you returns.
Mm.
So for you to be able to maybe say outsource for funding or look for funding, it should be driven by the demand of the product or service you are going to offer. Now, if let's say most people have been able to get certain funding, but the results,
okay.
Yeah. So look, I would prefer that you focus on the quality, that quality that is driven by the demand. Then after you have established that, then you look at maybe how much do you need for you to be able to have an added advantage. Because funding is just, it's to facilitate you.
Mm.
Yeah, but what is the driving force for your business to be able to succeed?
So hold on to the right principles. The rest just have to play along.
Yes, because if you look at certain people have been able to make it out without funding in terms of maybe innovation or technology.
Yeah.
You are able to create something that is of high quality, that is on demand, that is going to drive, or it's going to create a new market. And if you are able to create a new market or a new product, that will fetch for you higher value and you'll be able to generate more revenue without getting any funding.
All right, so Vincent, on this segment of Business Clinic, we really seek to find solutions to businesses that are starting, struggling, about to collapse, and all that. Just talk us then through how a business that is thinking about restocking in such times, because you know, you probably have friends that buy from you or friends that are waiting to buy from you. So you are moving into a business and restocking, hoping that, wait, my friends said they would support me.
Yeah. So for you to maybe undertake any further investment into the business, you have to look at which level you are at. Let's say in terms, maybe the failure level or the growth level, at where the business
how
is.
How do you estimate that growth of failure level?
Yeah, no, in terms of maybe failure level, you look at maybe you are underperforming, maybe you are in distress, or the business is in trouble, depending on, in terms of the goals you set out.
Yes.
Let's say maybe you're not meeting your daily operation. Let's say your expenses are higher than your income. Then maybe you are able to not meet your obligation in terms of, let's say, repaying your debt. So depending on where you are, that will guide you on how you should be able to restock. Now, for you to be able to restock, we have already highlighted the demand. Even if you restock when your product is not on demand,
you're wasting.
Yes. So should be driven by the level at which you are. Maybe you are underperforming. Now, if let's say the business is doing well in terms of growth level, so look at those also at the level at which the business is at. Now, if you restock, will it create for you more value in terms of competition? Or will it attract for you more revenue in terms of return? Then from there you can be able, should I maybe go for a higher quality product that is going to fetch for me a higher value.
Okay.
But if, let's say, maybe you are still upcoming in terms of a small business, then you need to restock in terms of maybe new product or a new process that is going to improve the performance of the business.
Let's just hold it from there, because when you talk about businesses in distress and high operational costs, what else are some of the factors that a business person should look at and say, oh, I think my business is starting to go down? What are some of the things, like pointers, what are some of the things that they need to pay attention to?
Yeah, the customer is the lifeblood of the business.
Mm.
So you have to look at your customers. Are you meeting, or what is the customer trying to do in terms of the service you're offering or the product?
Mm.
The customer wants to, maybe satisfaction. Are you satisfying your customer? Because it is this satisfaction that will bring back the customer.
Okay.
So if you start looking at that and you see that maybe there is a decline in terms of customers, it should give you a wake-up call. How do you readjust? You don't need something new, but work within the confinement in which you are operating in.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Then maybe look at the size.
Yes.
Now, the size of the business may also determine the performance, because some businesses are quick to establish new branches, which create more costs for the business.
Mm.
Yeah. So how do you ensure, because that is the growth we are talking about,
yes,
can you be able to build the business within your confinement in terms of operation, rather than maybe you try to create a new branch that will increase your expenses, yet the demand is low. So if you can go slowly, and you build, depending on how you improve on your customer base, as the numbers increase, then you can maybe think of an extra branch that will maybe yield for you something in more competition in the marketplace.
You're the guys in the market now. If someone watching wanted to find out and they asked, so what kind of business can I start around this time and thrive? If I paid attention to all the details that you've explained, what business do you think can thrive in such times?
Because there is no specific business you can say that this one will thrive. Because now we are in a changing environment.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we talked about the marketing knowledge. So it's up to you to see what is currently. You look at the gap. Where is the gap in the marketplace? Because you may bring something in new that is not on demand.
Mm.
You may work on something that is available, that you improve on the quality, that will maybe make you more competitive. You should maybe create a new process or a new system that is lacking in the market, that will give you an added advantage. So you look at, where is the gap in the market for you to bring out something that is on demand?
All right, so you recently authored a survey that did indicate how about 50% of businesses succumb to failure within just 3 years, and only 20% are still in existence after 5 years. Just how serious is that for us then?
Yeah, the picture is not looking good. So that is the focus at the rate at which businesses are failing.
Yes.
So considering the global environment in terms of the global economy, and because we are not in isolation, some of those external factors do impact on our businesses.
Yes.
But for us, our emphasis is what is the internal mechanism, the domestic factors that do affect the performance of these businesses. So for us, the emphasis is how do we ensure that we increase startups, ensure that these businesses grow, and we can increase the number of entrepreneurs that are going to drive this economy further.
Any closing shots for
me? I think that those struggling businesses should not give up. We have different mechanisms. We have turnaround, business turnaround. We have a rescue component to ensure that these businesses can grow. So if any business is in distress, how do you ensure that you improve your demand? How do you ensure that you cater for the customers? Because those are the lifeblood of the business. For you to be able to compete and to remain in the business operations.
Thank you for making time yesterday. Now, Mr. Blair, explaining to us all the basics you need to pay attention to as a business person every single day. We've seen the failure rate high, but it says don't give up. If you could put some things right, your business could be back up and running. Now, in such times, it's just really obvious for us to say, before we go, some of the basics that you need to pay attention to in such hard, unprecedented times. One, I know Ugandans love good lives, but look, if you can use one car as a family and save on fuel, that money can be translated into something else. So let's just cut the cost of how we transport ourselves. That's one. Two, change the way you spend on food, leisure, entertainment, whatever it is. Just pick up the basics. In such times, it's important to only deal with priorities. Not everything really matters now. But if you have the money, of course, go ahead and spend it. This is Clinic for this week. We'll be back again next week with a different topic and a different expert. Now, coming up is the big issue, and we're looking at the state of food, roadside food hygiene in the country. Good morning.
Following a report that was done in Saturday Vision paper that showed that the roadside chicken carries bacterial infection. Today I've decided to come deep down in these slum areas. I am in Nankulabi to talk about the same issue. I'll be interacting with different people who are dealing in this business to find out the truth whether this roadside chicken carries bacteria infection. I understand many Ugandans like this type of chicken, inclusive myself. Now I'm going to be talking to some of people who are dealing in this business who are going to take us through the proper preparation, how they prepare it, and is it true it carries bacterial infection. Oli live ku Urban TV 7, saba ku Uzaka Manya.
Yente Mumbele. Yeah.
Business etambula ite wane nankula.
Etambula mpola mpola nakuzino. Yeah.
Otunda ngoko.
Yeah, tunda ngoko.
Okay. Waliwo ekika ky'enkoko ky'otunda. Birimu ekika oba eba nkoko yonna. Mulimu enzungu, mulimu
eba nzungu gye tutunda wano. Iye. Asinganda. Iye.
Buli kifi kiri kusenta meka?
Ekifi kya 15. Iye.
Ekyo kiba kyenkana kitya? Kiba kinene kwenkana ki?
Ekifi.
Ndaga.
Kati. Ekifi kati kyenkana wano. Wechiti. Wechitio. Chichiba changu mitano.
Ate chidi chisembe yu wali?
Enwevera hafu. Enwevera hafu. Kati hafu wevera kenda bitano. Iye.
Na ichi gambi wengu keno teja burunji. Ntimuji fumba munda nesigana mu musayi. Eira eba mubu uka umutu wabaji ride. Chitufu.
Abali imba. Kubanga ulaba wenji sala wentio. Au chiba chirunji. Sobolo kuja. Burunji nyo nekala burunji. Musayi neugutabela mu. Iye.
Kati bobo jiteka teka, oruji sala ngo jireta ngo jiteka kubo inebirungo vyo soko teka?
Ebirungo, soko kuteka kwe birungo, nga ginger, then garlic, nenyongera kochi, nenyongera kone pepper. Yeah.
Okay. Angira boji saze boti obojikalirira oba ojikalirira namba ngeri jenengere limunda.
Kati soko nenjikalirira bwentyo nge namba bwa ngabola beno. Iye, njikalirira bwentyo. Kati customer bwa janga yagala order nga nge namba ne tujisalasala bwetu tyo. Iye.
Na hiyo muliro nganda banga mutono. Muliro guno gutukira dala mundo bagukoma.
Ye, gutukira munda dala ne guingire ngoko neja bulungi. Iye, kati ngabo olaba emuku zino wanweno. Kati ya ngoko eba eri half done. Kati we tujiteka wanweno ebera kati ngeri ready.
Ojikalirira kumala banga chokufuka ngabo eri.
Kati kitwala dakika 30 okubera bwetyo. Okay. Iye.
Kati fa bali benkuku hini nkalirire kuko magezi kigotuwa kubanga tujera likire bisere bisinga waliwo abagamba ntugule enkuku eyo ne tujiria naye mundo ogendo sanga nganjeru ngeri muno otusayisayi mugenda kula mutya ensonge
kati nga fe sawa zino engoko fe tujifumba bulungi paka wena kala nebera kilia ngo mundo asobola ojiria nebo ojimenya mu nga tosobola okusanga mu musayigo nagona ngeri red kale iye.
Okay, all right. I'll be talking to other people. Those of you who are still watching the Rush Hour, as you've heard, is one of those who deal in that business. There is a lady here. Let me just have an interview with her. Nyabo Jebaleko.
Nyangoma Melvin.
Business etambulete nangu.
Wait, mpola mpola.
Abantu enkoko bagula.
Nyo.
Ujitunda sente mekabulichi.
Kumitano.
Waluwe chigambi wanti enkoko eno teja munda ejjolu libalo okungulu ne ate munda tejjo lina ajiryanga munda mbisi nebanga elimu obuuka kitufu
si kitufu ebeide
kati mumujiteka muteka mtu okulabanga ejja bulungi
tujizamu mu butone kala bulungi
Okay, birungo chibi oteka mkuba ni naje nengira wali eringe limu birungo. Birungo chibi oteka mwao.
Reiko, katunguru, galiki, sako nentanga uzi. Bimu bijiyamba kuka wawo, bimu kujua omesa.
Ishitegeza abaganti yanguku munda teji ya bachamu.
Bachamu. Tomanya kubabu liomaba inengeri jakulamu ebibi.
All right, now, Lynn, Mubarak and the team, those are some of the people who are preparing this type of roast chicken. As you can see, the street is going to be so busy. Other people are just coming in to unwrap their businesses at this time. I'm going to be talking to another lady here and, of course, add on the voices of the many who we have talked to. She sells chips, as you can see. You allow me to come this side so I can have a clear view. Nyapo Jebaleko.
Kari sewo nawe Jebaleko.
Uli live kwa Banti Vyamanya.
Natembo Topista. Business, wetyo.
Ate enkoko ilietia wano, ya sente mmeka?
Enkoko, chifichibacha yanku mitano. Chifichibacha yanku mitano.
Toba muna chabiri.
Nedda. Echebite kirimu ebintu bya bbeeyi nnyo na mu bimanyi.
Tunyonnyolemu engeri gy'oteekateeka enkoko y'eno nga waakagigula paka kw'oyo agigula n'agirya.
Enkoko eno bwe ngituusa ku mudaala gwange, ngiteekamu ebirungo, ngiteekamu Reiko chicken, nteekamu ginger, that is entangawuzi, nteekamu garlic, then ne onion. Ne mbikola ne mixinga, ne nsooka ngiteekateeka. Ate n'omuntu naye ajja okugigula era bwe mmala ogiteekateeka musaliramu akatungulu akabisi ne muteerako cabbage ne muteerako n'ennyaanya. Kisinzira choice y'omuntu. Oyinza oga nti nze mbyagala njagala salads oba sizaagala.
Waliwo ekigambibwa nti enkoko ono munda tejja naddala netundibwa ku makubo nti oli olugirya agenda otuuka munda nga njeru ngeri muno otusayisaayi ekibeera eky'obulabe ennyo eri obulamu bw'omuntu. Kino kituufu?
Si kituufu kubanga nsooka ne ngisiika. Kasuma wajogula enkoko then nenjikwatira nenjiza mu butto nenjikaza okitegera kati kizibu okutwa kasuma okutwala enkoko nga teyidde
kati waliwo enkalirire namwe abateeka mu butto enkalirire yo jina ka idea
Enkayire nze sijina ko idea. Je nyina ko idea yeno je nkole iyo mu butto.
All right. Lynn Mubarak, and those of you who are still watching the rush hour, you allow me to speak to our last gentleman here. He's busy, as you can see, preparing his chicken, ready to be taken home. I'll be discussing with him on the same matter. Sebo Jebale, ko sibiotia.
Sibio Urunjo, sibiotia.
Business etambulete.
Hey, business etambula mpola mpola, mbela ya kanso vitegele.
Akakoka akakalamba kameka.
Kata akalamba kali kugumukenda. Nga mulimu chips jibe biri biri.
Ukasubula meka.
Akakoko nkasubula gumu kitundu. Nga uwe chitegera masanyalaze. Wano tuwa tino sasura nanyi ni chifo.
Okay. Kakati, waliwo ekigambi bwanti enkoko eno mwe abatunda enkoko ku kkubo. Enkoko eno tejja. Kituufu?
Okujjako oyinza osanga nga tuli ku bwangu. Ng'oyagala akayidde ng'otambulamu naffe tukakuweerayo n'otambulirawo.
So kampanga tekayidde wemba ku bwangu?
Naye ebiseera ebisinga tuwawo eziyidde. Okujjako oyinza osanga olinga akuteeka ku pulesa ng'ayagalako obwangu ate oba oyina ojjiwa obudde n'ejja bulungi. Awo bw'ojja ng'oli ku pulesa ng'ogamba mpa akayidde ng'ende oba ng'otuteeka ku pulesa awo tulaba ng'oli wakkaayana tujikuweerayo nga bw'eri.
Enkoko eno bw'oba ogiteekateeka ogisalaasalamu oba ogimuwangana?
Nsalaasalamu ebifi ne ngiteekamu kabbeji, nyaanya n'obutungu ne green pepper n'otambulirawo nga kiri.
Oyogedde ku muntu oli ali ku bwangu. Okusinga omumwe enkoko etayidde bulungi kuba kiba kya bulabe eri obulamu. Lwaki oba tomugamba nti enkoko gy'otutte tennajja bulungi ojja lwala?
Anti waliwo omuntu akulaga enjala n'akulaga fazalo oleka nkoko akubbe engumi n'agenda. Waliwo bano abajja ng'olaba atamidde yakuwadde ssente ate ng'olina muwa nkoko ye. Kale okakanya okumukakanya ng'ogiteekamu ekirungo eba eyiddaayiddemu nga bwe tugiteeka wano eba eyiddaayiddemu kati ogiteeka wano n'ejjamu katono nnyo. N'ogimuwa n'atambulirawo. Amaanya yenze muwanguzi Daniyo. Mbeera wano enankulabye ku labamba enkoko n'echips byonna bibeerawo mu magezi.
Alright, it's so interesting. And those of you who like this type of chicken when you are drunk, it is likely to be very dangerous towards your lives. The team in the studio, you've heard from different people here who are dealing in this type of business. Let me get back to you in studio so we can take on this conversation. Brian Alvins Mgera is my name. Good morning.
And well done, well done. Chicken, oh my God. That gentleman just revealed a lot of things that I think the report really alluded to. So we are talking the state of the roadside food hygiene. And man, I'm still a bit disturbed from what Brian picked from there. But thank you very much, Brian, for going all the way to get those details of how everything is prepared. You guys love chicken on the roadside. Now you have seen for yourselves. Bacteria's everywhere. And joining me in that regard is Chirabo Jackie, a nutritionist, and we're going to have a look at when we were off air. She was already bothered by the situation that was going on. Jackie, a very good morning and welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. About the topic of roadside chicken, it has been bothering me so much as an individual. When you look at firstly the way the food is exposed, it's uncovered. And dust is on there, we have insects going there, and then someone just passes by and gets a piece. It's literally they're buying sickness for themselves.
You know, you saw the almost cooked and ready chicken next to the raw one, and you're like, no, that's wrong. Why? How wrong is that? I mean, it's the norm on the streets.
And actually, when it comes to food preparation, raw food should be separated from cooked food. You cannot put raw chicken close to cooked chicken. It's not acceptable. Mm-hmm. So because cooked food already bacteria destroyed. Right. Now raw food already contains the bacteria. You cannot see the bacteria with your eyes.
Yeah.
For example, now salmonella, you will not see it.
Well, slow down. Salmonella is what?
Salmonella is a bacteria that causes foodborne illnesses.
Ah.
Yes.
Wow, wow. Science, some of these things you need to understand. So go on, please.
So you cannot see the bacteria with your own eyes, and that's why those people just keep mixing the food up. They bring it because they can't see, but this bacteria later on could lead to diarrhea, could lead to nausea, and those are things that literally take a toll on your health, especially in this age where we have things like COVID. We have very many other illnesses going on. You need to take care of yourself. Roadside chicken is not bad, but get chicken from a very hygienic place.
Now, talking about nutrition and hygiene, what's the importance of hygiene in nutrition? Because everybody wants to eat a very sumptuous food and yummy. And trust me, the food on the streets, when I'm hungry, it looks super yummy. Tell me about that.
Actually, the relationship with food and nutrition is firstly, hygiene comes first even before the food. It does not matter how nutritious your food is. If it's in an unhygienic environment, it's not really healthy for you.
Yeah.
I could take a look at the video that you saw earlier. Mm-hmm. Those people were showing vegetables and fruits, and these are raw foods. Most of them are partially cooked.
Yeah.
So when it comes to raw food, we even take hygiene on another level.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when it comes to handling,
yes,
food handling, because this food is not cooked at all. So hygiene takes a higher, I could say it's more important than just the food.
Right, right.
Yes.
So in your nutrition journey, in making sure that we eat well and live well, because experts are warning that people are rather have poor hygiene practices. Do you know any of those? Have you encountered any of those poor hygiene practices?
Yes, I've encountered many of them. Firstly, hand washing, most people do not wash their hands even before eating food, even after visiting a toilet. Yet these are really cores for our wellness and well-being. When it comes to disease prevention, hygiene takes the first place, because it does not matter how nutritious or healthy your food is. If it's unhygienic, it's so going to destroy your health.
That's very worrying, because most people who are into nutrition, trying to watch their weight, trying to watch what kind of food they eat, including roadside, they'll tell you, I would rather eat roasted and versus the fried one. But then we see there's a lot wanting there. People who are on a diet, for example, they usually advise vegetables. Let's talk about the real things here. Vegetables always have pesticides. They're exposed to pesticides. As a nutritionist, Jackie, how can one handle vegetables, the hygiene that is required? How do I tell that the vegetables I'm eating are clean and free of chemicals?
Well, thank you so much for such a beautiful question. Firstly, some vegetables really carry the pesticides. For example, tomatoes, you can see the white pesticide that has been used. Before you use raw tomatoes, you need to make sure that you've cleaned off every pesticide that is there, and then you can wash your vegetables with vinegar and bicarbonate of soda. This really helps. If you see any visible pesticides on the vegetables, it's important that you clean all of them. I've seen some greens, spinach, but that still does not take away the fact that fruits and vegetables are really, really necessary for our well-being.
Okay. And the roadside food, that one is still a big challenge for the people. And Jackie, in your journey as a nutritionist, what more in regard to food hygiene have you come across? And what more would you like our viewer out there to understand?
Firstly, when it comes to food hygiene, it's important that you know where the food is coming from. Most of us just go to restaurants and sit. We do not know how the kitchen looks like. We don't know, even the people that are serving us are really not looking hygienic, as we should say.
Uh-huh.
There are kitchen standards, SOPs, to make sure that the food that you eat is very hygienic.
Mm-hmm.
And most kitchens actually do not take these on. However, you as a client, you need to observe. You need to really be so keen to make sure that what you're getting is very hygienic, very healthy, and this will help you to not get diarrhea, to not get nauseated because of such things that can be managed.
Earlier on, you mentioned salmonella. Is that the only bacteria common with food?
Not really. There is E. coli. there is Campylobacter, and all these actually they affect infants and children so much.
Yeah.
Even adults, they could affect you. Foodborne illnesses are something we can avoid. Yes.
Avoid how? By just cooking?
Not just cooking, but proper food handling, storage. Storage is also very key when it comes to food, the refrigeration, the recycling. They are all very important. Yes.
Recycling, handling. Those of you who don't like, I've seen people who don't wash their hands before they eat, even when they're from the bathroom. Yeah, it's that bad. So yeah, food hygiene is key in everything you do. But most importantly, if you are going to eat something, even if it's just a fruit, even if it's just chicken, yeah, we are hungry for chicken. Chicken has been a problem for a long time. So thank you very much, Jackie, for the insight into the state of food, of roadside food hygiene, and how we can handle that moving forward. Coming up in a short while is us looking at a hunger and starvation in Karamoja. There's been reports going on. We're going to speak to members of parliament. We're going to speak to people on ground to let us know what's happening actually in Karamoja. Is there hunger for sure? If it is there, what can we do about it? We'll be right back after that.